This talk is based on my recent book, Voices of Dissent, in which I discuss some forms of dissent from the Indian past, and some of which I link with the present. I shall begin by trying to define what I mean by dissent. I shall then discuss two broad examples of major dissenting ideas from two past traditions. And in the latter part of the talk, I shall refer to a couple of examples of dissent that suggest a link between the comprehension of dissent in past times with some of the ways in which it has been expressed in our times. My interest in the subject is not recent, nor was it roused primarily by increasing attempts to disallow dissenting opinion in many parts of the world today, including in our society. I have been writing on the concept of dissent in pre-modern India, off and on, for the last half century. I see dissent as central to social and cultural change, a centrality that is not new to history, but tends to be ignored very often in the study of Indian history. Even the evolving of what we call civilization is a process in which dissent and consent were exercised in the selection of that which is acceptable and that which is to be rejected. The selection was made by contemporary evaluation as also by later historians. We pay little attention to these selections as debates, assuming that the process was constantly consensual. My other purpose is to suggest that the continuity of the presence of dissent in various forms through the centuries was essential. Some characteristic forms can be recognized as having continued to be effective in present times as well. And my example of this will come from the Indian National Movement for Independence and our subsequent efforts to establish a democratic society. Let me begin then by attempting to define what I mean by dissent. It stems from a difference of opinion or a disagreement, but is not arbitrary. It may begin with minor disagreement, but is recognized as dissent when it refers to a specific issue of some substance that introduces alternative ideas both in thought and in practice. Dissent, therefore, has to be directed to a matter of importance. It can be a form of protest, although protest is generally more organized. Therefore, it is better perhaps to say that dissent can change into or become a form of protest. A distinguishing and significant feature is that dissent is non-violent. Dissent tends to be more vocal in what we call complex societies that bring together a variety of communities following diverse occupations, social rules, and belief systems. The greater needs of variant cultures can encourage dissent among some. Dissent is significant, for instance, to the kind of cultures that are brought together in what we call civilizations. The process of formulating the requirements of civilization, for instance, meant selecting ideas and forms of expression, discarding some, and furthering others. This interplay of conformity and dissent cannot be ignored. Dissent encourages the questioning of the world in which we live, and in this process, alternatives are formulated. Any advance in knowledge requires questioning existing knowledge. Existing explanations sometimes give way to newer and better ones. Otherwise, there is bound to be stagnation. Dissent lies at the root of philosophical discourse, as is stated more than once in Indian philosophical discussion. For example, it is said that when making a statement of some consequence, the first step is to state clearly and at length the views of the opponent disagreeing with the proposed argument, what is referred to as the purva paksha. The second step is the refutation of this argument by the proponent, the pratipaksha. And finally, there is a debate or dialogue on the two views in the hope for a solution, the siddhanta. This seemingly dialectical method appears to have been practiced in the debates that are referred to as taking place in royal courts. As for instance, the debate between the Shaivas and the Buddhists at the court of Harshavardhan of Kannauj in the 7th century AD. What this procedure recognizes is the centrality of dissent and the importance of dialogue in the search for a solution when dissent is registered. My examples of dissent are from the religions of pre-modern India. This is not because I think that religion is the primary area where dissent is registered, but because dissent can be seen with greater clarity in every religion. Secondly, my concern is not with dissent in theology, but in the social theories that religions construct, especially those that attract a following through explaining human existence. The explanations were diverse. In modern times, however, attempts were made to bring all religious movements in India, other than the Abrahamic, under a single umbrella. They were seen as multiple manifestations of the same religious doctrine, with few dissenting opinions. This, at least, was helpful in understanding them, as not all conform and many disagree. Recognizing the disagreement makes them more visible. And in the study of Indian religion, it is often the diverse sects of each religion that give direction to religious evolution, rather than any monolithic unities that we today ascribe to them. Religious institutions reflect social values and activity. And apart from monasteries and nunneries that are distinct from society, there are institutions such as places of worship or schools of learning that contribute substantially to the actions and ethics of a society. The intersection of religious ideas and social activities often led to dissenting opinions and the breaking away of a group, giving rise to a religious sect. An example of this was the debate in one of the early Buddhist councils, subsequent to the death of the Buddha, on whether the Sangha should permit monks to accept monetary donations, a fundamental debate that all religions should discuss. The multiple sects that sprout around every religion can be expressions of deviation or dissent, or can be modifications of existing forms. A sect finds its place somewhere along the spectrum. This is a different pattern from a single monotheism unified by creed and catechism. And this pluralism is characteristic of religion in India and may well relate to the particular social structures that prevail. Let me illustrate what I am saying with a couple of examples where dissent has been crucial to the form taken by the religions. An early articulation of this is what began as a parallel movement, but dissented significantly from established religion. Vedic Brahmanism was the dominant religious presence in the earlier part of the first millennium BC. multiple gods were worshipped, not as icons, but through elaborate sacrificial rituals that consumed much of the wealth that was produced. Its ethics drew on the belief in the reincarnation of the individual soul and what was to become the famous theory of karma. This view met with dissent from what had been broadly termed the Shramana religions. Buddhists in the main, but including Jains and Ajivikas. Other dissenters, the Charvak or Lokayat, taught a firmly materialist philosophy. They all denied the existence of deities. Consequently, Vedic texts could not be taken as divinely revealed and therefore sacred. Forms and locations of worship differed from the Vedic, as did the definition of reincarnation and possible liberation from it. Causal explanations were based on reason and logic, and this dissent was only broadly uniform among the Shramanas, as they too registered degrees of disagreement among themselves. References to the Brahmin-Shramana confrontation are explicit in the edicts of the Mauryan king Ashoka. He pleaded for greater tolerance and harmony among them. The period from the Mauryas to the Guptas is one in which the competition is apparent. And in the post-Gupta period, it is Brahmanism that emerges triumphant. Brahmanical writing refers to these dissenters as nastika, non-believers, sometimes even viewed as heretics. The term continued to be used for them in Sanskrit texts as late as the 16th century AD. The grammarian Patanjali compares the hostility between the Brahmins and the Shramans to that between the snake and the mongoose. The term nastika was not confined to the Shramanas. It was extended to include all non-believers. Thus, in a reference from a 16th century text, nastikas, non-believers, included the Turushkas, literally Turks, as applied to people from Central Asia and later to Muslims. This, of course, brings to mind the Islamic term kafir. The irony was that the Turushka did believe in deity and God, but his deity was Allah and not any of the Brahmanical gods, so he was a non-believer. He was regarded as a non-believer. The Shramanas were nastika because they originally did not believe in any deity. Buddhism had its own dissenters. A significant dichotomy separated the Hinayana and the Mahayana sects, interpreting the teachings of the Buddha through multiple differentiated sects. This was also noticeable when Buddhist missionary activity came to the fore in Central Asia and China during the first millennium AD. It met with conditions different from what it had known in the subcontinent. And this led to fresh questions, new answers, and sometimes, quite often, the founding of a new sect. The degree of demarcation from the existing religious order was variable. The success of a religion depends on its relationship with society, and particularly with those in authority and the elite who provide the patronage and the donations for rituals. A popular following gives it a different kind of support, and the Shramanas had to compete for patronage to establish their social base. But monastic institutions establishing an alternative system were dependent on society. Vedic Brahmanism had a wealthy, prestigious, generally elite patronage. The popular religion that grew out of these beginnings was what is now being called by scholars of Hinduism, Puranic Hinduism. It did not formally descend from Vedic Brahmanism, but left it to its own Brahmanical devices. Puranic Hinduism gave prominence to certain newer deities and forms of worship, deities of the Vaishnav, the Shaiv, and the Shakta traditions. And under these labels, it also included many local cults. The focus was on deity. One among the many had prominence, and these deities had either been absent or marginal in Vedic worship. Each of the major deities of Puranic Hinduism were maintained by distinctive sects with distinctive texts, such as the Purans. Variations within the sects had a large range. Origins, myths, and rituals were recorded irrespective of whether deities were old or even very recent. Like most religions, Puranic Hinduism had both a gentle side with close human manifestations of deities that the worshipper was comfortable with, as also the more wrathful, angry manifestation of deities. In some forms, they became icons of love, devotion, and passion and compassion, the emotions that guided their worship. One might ask whether this emphasis also drew partly from the Shramana tradition, with little emphasis on deity, as well as the Bhakta tradition, which endorsed this gentler side. Hindu institutions were parallel to but different from those of the Shramanas. Temples replaced chaityas, sometimes literally, and often became places of pilgrimage, thereby attracting commercial activities as well. Icons of the deities were introduced with elaborate rituals, some invented afresh. The monastery was as yet alien to Brahmanism, although something echoing it, like the mutt, became a focus of propagation. The renouncer, by contrast, became a monk or a nun, but continued to have limited links with society. And in this, the renouncer is different from the ascetic, who was ideally self-exiled and living in isolation. Renunciation was central to Shramanism, being the path to Nirvana. It involved dissent from Brahmanical teaching, opting out of social obligations, and adopting an alternative monastic life, focusing on self-liberation, moksha. However, it was not self-isolation, since contact with society was necessary. The monk had to collect his food as alms from people in the vicinity, and his concern about their well-being was required by the teaching. Violence was disallowed. It can be seen as a reciprocal relationship with society, one that was new and different from what had existed before. The ideal, the symbol, the practice of renunciation was implicit in the image of what came to be called the man who heals, performs miracles, meditates, and is helpful in misfortune. The man whom we today call the holy man. He is not the priest. He lives distanced from society, but wanders through villages and towns. And as an icon, his choice of being a holy man could be used effectively, but could also be abused in giving direction to a community, as often happens. People, after all, can be gullible. The later incoming religions brought new ideas. These could either create dissent or be amalgamated into new practices and beliefs. The mixing and the merging of new religious ideas takes shape, for instance, with the coming of various forms of Islam. We refer to this event as starting with the Arabs invading Sindh in the 8th century AD. But in fact, their more effective and long-lasting entry was as traders all down the west coast of India, from Gujarat to Kerala. The religious mix that emerged took the form of new socio-religious sects, in origin drawing from both Puranic Hinduism and Islam, but not conforming to either and evolving independently. Sects such as the early Bohras, Khojas, Mapilas, Navayats, and such like. The entry of Turks, Afghans, and Mughals into northwestern India followed from the familiarity that Central Asia had had with northern India previously. This was through continuing migrations from early times and commercial exchanges from Kushan times onwards with the silk trade, the horse trade, and such like. The Central Asian presence was intensified at historical moments through invasion, but it was actually more firmly established with migration and settlement. Various schools of Sufi sects spread their version of Islam with their diverse ideas and practices, dissenting from or borrowing from existing religions in India. One of the most interesting examples of this were the borrowings between the Nath Yogis and the Sufis in the Punjab. This is one explanation as to why the proponents of Krishna Bhakti, devotion to the deity Krishna, the incarnation of Vishnu, were not only devotees such as Vallabhacharya and Suddas, but also came from well-placed Muslim families. Sayyid Ibrahim Khan or Ras Khan and Abdul Rahim Khan Khanan or Rahim are among those who composed dohas, couplets in Hindi, in praise of Krishna and Radha. The verses are still sung as bandishes in Hindustani classical music. Such devotees were treated as dissenters by the proponents of orthodoxy in both religions, by both the Qazis, the Mullahs and the Maulavis, as well as the Pandits and the Brahmins. Bhakti is, as a form of religion, had multiple nuclei all over the subcontinent. Their verses were devotional and by implication were often social comments. In our times, these multiple sects have been treated as part of one unified monolithic religious movement. They were actually diverse and responded to specific local religious and regional requirements. They were not defining a subcontinental religion. The diversity and the dissent is apparent. Each bhakti sant, I don't like the term saint, I prefer the original sant. Each bhakti sant worshipped one deity of choice in his or her own way, with or without rituals, and often through songs, hymns, and narratives in the local language. There was, therefore, an obvious diversity geared to the local region, although there were a few broad similarities. Deities differed, or the same one was worshipped but in another way, and of course in another language. So the nuances were not the same. We may well ask, why was there a difference? Generally, little or no mention is made of other bhakts from distant places. Neither Kabir nor Mirabai, for example, mention the Alvars or the Nayanars of the Tamil-speaking region. For some sants, the worship of the deity was paramount. But for others, it was the message of social equality implicit in their devotion. Thus, Ravidas describes his utopia not as a paradise, but as the imagined city of Berampura, the city where there is no sorrow, Begum, because the social equality of all is prevalent. Social equality is also asserted in the ritual of organized pilgrimages among some sects and among many sects. Those congregating in devotion are all treated as of equal status. This breaks two of the fundamental rules of caste. They eat together and there is no prohibition on touching. For the period of pilgrimage, the rules of the Dharmashastras do not apply. Even in those religions that preached the equality of all in the eyes of God, social difference was marked and treated as necessary. The separation between acceptable castes and the lower castes and untouchables was in practice universal across religions. Places of worship or areas within the normal places of worship were demarcated and segregated. And we need to inquire into the forms of dissent that the excluded castes, the avarnas as they are called, Dalits as we call them today, may have adopted, although not perhaps openly so. Let me repeat that dissent was always present as an undercurrent in the ideas and movements associated with many aspects of life. Barring the orthodox, religion at all social levels was malleable and adjusted, either visibly or invisibly, to social and political change, as is evident from the histories of the sects. There is, for instance, much mutation and reformulation of religions in colonial times, and the presence of dissent needs greater recognition, especially in times of historical change. What have been called socio-religious reform movements in the 19th century, the Brahmo Samaj, Arya Samaj, Prarthana Samaj, and such like, were inevitably imprinted with some colonial ideas. They questioned Brahmin orthodoxy, but with the intention of suggesting reform rather than any heterodox replacement. The Arya Samaj, for instance, reconstructed Vedic society as a utopia and propagated returning to Vedic values and practices. Calls for returning to tradition often draw on a virtually invented tradition in accord with the ideological and social needs of present times. Among these, the traditions that were recalled and invented, among these was nationalism, speaking for the emergence of a new socio-political structure, namely a nation state. Some advocated it as a new utopia, that of a secular democratic state. Others reversed this by imagining a future state identified with the majority religion as its most significant feature. Democratic nationalism was a protest against colonial rule, articulated in various ways of dissent and converted into a manifestation of social and political protest. The form it took in the early 20th century was seemingly new to the anti-colonial secular national movement for independence. The question I am asking is, was it an entirely new experience for the Indian people? The protest, incorporating degrees of dissent, attracted a large number of people who became supporters of secular nationalism. This nationalism was distinct from the nascent but growing religious nationalisms, the Muslim and the Hindu. These latter had a different agenda and teleology. Their intention was to establish religious majoritarian states, the Islamic as Pakistan, and the possibly imminent Hindu Rashtra. These two religious nationalisms took their cue from the colonial understanding of Indian history and consequently could not and did not confront colonial power. Their ideas were based on colonial thinking. Religious nationalism, by its very premise, cannot accommodate democracy. Primacy given to a particular category of citizens, whether based on religion, ethnicity, or language, or whatever, conflicts with the idea of the equal rights of all citizens fundamental to democracy. Religious nationalism and democracy are in conflict. The secular national movement envisaging a democratic nation state took forward some of these ideas of dissent as had been formulated in earlier times. These were more in keeping with the requirements of groups protesting against colonial rule. A few earlier forms of dissent surfaced again. Among them were two that were adapted by Gandhi as among his forms of protest. One was the Dharna, going on a hunger strike, and the other was what he called Satyagraha. His awareness of deliberately adapting earlier forms of dissent and protest is being researched. Mine is just a hint, a possible glance in that direction. What I am arguing in this discussion of dissent is that in early India is that we should look more closely at the links between the past and the present. One among the many reasons for the success of these forms of dissent in the 20th century may have been that the Indian people were familiar with these forms as a recognized articulation of dissent. They were not entirely unknown forms of dissent. Where Gandhi resorts to fasts to make a political demand, either from the colonial power or from competing nationalisms, he is projected as an independent person with the stature of a Mahatma, literally the great soul, in effect, rather similar to the holy man that I was talking about earlier. He takes it upon himself to speak for the people of India in supporting their demand for freedom or to live in harmony, else he will lose his life. As one symbolizing dissent, he needed the stature to take this position. This was recognized both by the Indian people and by the colonial power, directly or indirectly. Gandhi's major formulation of a method of dissent, which became associated with him, was what he called Satyagraha, literally holding the truth. The creation of this form of dissent drew partly and perhaps subconsciously from a tradition of dissent that prevailed in many cultures of India and which I have referred to earlier. Thus, I would argue that Satyagraha was a form of dissent that evoked older practices in a modern situation and without consciously linking it to older forms. It can be called dissent since it has characteristics familiar to the Indian people, recalled by the continuing presence of the renouncers, the bhakti sants, the yogis, the peers and fakirs, and other categories of what are often called holy men, what I sometimes call those who opt out of society. The iconic use of the phrase, the half-naked fakir for Gandhi, evoked unintentionally the established tradition of dissenters. All of the latter claimed the right to deny their consent to what existed if they so wished. These characteristics are evident. Dissent is not just disagreement. Its intention has an objective. The objective in South Africa was not identical with the later one in India. Nevertheless, dissent is directed towards political and social change and ensuring the well-being of people. This makes it reminiscent of the aims of the earlier dissenters, the Shramanas and the Bhakti Sants. It does not merely advocate a return to the vague fantasy of a golden age. It defines that age, even if differently. Nonviolence is a marked component, hence its description as passive resistance and civil disobedience. It endorses a dialogue between opposite opinions in order to arrive at a solution, reminiscent of the method suggested in early times for solving opposing arguments. It speaks to and includes all and every citizen of a nation, men and women. It is specifically not majoritarianism. Implicit in its thinking is the need for the foundation of a society to be democratic. It is irrespective of religion, of caste, or of status. Women are encouraged to participate. The presence of women is particularly striking, as indeed it was in the earlier movements of dissent. It was the Shramanas that permitted women to take up renunciation as nuns, admittedly after some debate and persuasion. Women sons, such as Andal, Meera, Laldeed, were accepted as teachers. It is often forgotten that the confined condition of women, as advocated in the Dharma Shastra texts, is not what was advocated in all texts and practices in past times. Many were different, whatever the degree of difference. The national movement did not necessarily treat all women as liberated citizens. It was the realization that if dissent is to be effective as passive resistance, it must be the voice of both men and women. The salt satyagraha was one such. It would be worth knowing in greater detail how such events were given form, who participated and why, apart from the call of the Mahatma. It is equally important to ascertain the reaction of the participants to how they understood the essential meaning of such activities. After 1947, passive resistance on any subcontinental scale has not been used when disagreeing with the laws of any government. Nevertheless, sporadic expressions of dissent have been and can be the reason for arrest, as has happened earlier under colonial governments and continues to this day. What comes to mind, however, are the two recent events of Shaheen Bagh and the farmers' protest in the vicinity of Delhi. Shaheen Bagh and protests linked to it in other cities had a larger component of women and of students expressing their opposition to the new law, the Citizen Amendment Act of the government, debarring some categories of people from citizenship. The overwhelming presence of women and Muslim women was deeply significant. It was women opposing patriarchy and gender discrimination and the rules of orthodoxies. In endorsing the Constitution, these women were also stating their support for secularism. The farmers' protest was against newly formulated laws on agricultural produce. The protesters were nonviolent in both cases, demanding a dialogue on the recently passed laws and their future. This also ties into the bigger question inherent to decisions in a democracy as to how these laws were being received by those most closely affected by them. In a democratic society, it is not only the lawmakers whose voice is to be heard, but those who are affected by the law, their voices and reactions should also be heard. Dissenting views today have a new dimension. We are no longer a colony ruled by a colonizer. We have been aspiring to function as a nation state, that is, as a secular democracy. In this context, protests can also be viewed as a comment on the questions being raised in discussions in many places. Do we need to fine-tune the concept of democracy to prevent it being derailed, as is feared that this is happening in some situations? Inevitably, the wider aspects of democracy have to be discussed, such as additional ways of debating disagreement and finding solutions to the problems that we are facing today. Does elected representation suffice in conveying what people want? How, for example, can we strengthen the institutions that protect democracy? Can the three constitutional pillars, the legislature, the executive, and the judiciary, be made more secure and autonomous, especially as guardians of the rights of citizens? Such questions are pertinent in the context of how democracy should function now and in the future. The failures in democratic functioning in the past century, with authoritarian systems and dictatorships coming to power in parts of Europe and Asia, Italy, Germany, Russia, China, had disastrous consequences for humanity. The repetition of that pattern is not called for. One may ask as to what Gandhi would have said to recent forms of passive resistance. A distinction between the colonial situation and that in an independent nation state should be evident when it comes to the role of dissent. The passive resistance of Gandhi asserted dissent and evolved into protest. The legitimacy of such forms in a democratic nation state draw on public opinion. In some polities across the world today, dissent is treated as an anti-national act. Yet, it is well established that the pivot of a liberal secular democracy is a wide-ranging debate prior to decisions, which has to come to terms with dissenting views. Let me repeat what our philosophy from the past maintains. There can be no Siddhanta solution if the views of the Purva Paksha, the opponent, are silenced by the Pratipaksha, the proponent. The articulation of the dialogue and debate between the two is absolutely essential. Let me say in conclusion, therefore, that it is imperative that we understand the historical centrality of dissent. It was and is essential to the formulating of cultures and to the establishing of democratic forms and norms. We have to recognize the inevitability of dissent in the events that shaped our history and that are now shaping the present.